Hi guys, welcome to another vlog of Be Busy Bee. In this video, we'll see how you can paint a photograph in the size of a photograph. So for this, the obvious first step is to choose your reference image. Here it's pretty simple. If you have a great scenery outside your house, then you can click one of its photos and you can start painting. But if you don't, then you have to go on to Google or Pinterest or Instagram and choose any good scenery photo, and then you can start to paint. But what's important here is to understand what a good reference image is and what a bad reference image is. For example, in this photo, if you can see, it's the aerial view of the ocean, and what your subject is not clear because there are several trees around the ocean. So once you have your reference image decided, now what you have to do is look at your material. For the paints, preferably acrylic is good, but if you have gouache by any chance, then great, because I'll be using gouache today. But more or less, you can also use acrylic, but there are some differences between what gouache is and acrylic is, but let's not get into that chemistry, because let's save that for another video. So this is an important part when it comes to painting photographs, that is a 3M tape, which locally is also called as the magic tape. So what you have to do is you have to stick this tape around your white color paper, and apart from that, when it comes to the paper, you should never paint in your notebooks, because that paper is not right. That's only meant for writing or probably sketching, but not for painting. So for painting, you will need at least a 200 or more GSM of the paper. So before you even start to paint, you need to analyze your photograph and see what the background is and what the foreground is, because be it any painting, you always go from background to foreground and never vice versa, because that is easier and also it gives you that realistic look without even trying. So here, if you see, my background has a lot of green, but it's not just green, it has blends of dark green to light green to some really light to lime green also. So what I'll do is I'll just gather all these colors. Now here, what you need to understand is when it comes to painting nature, you'll never find any straight solid colors in nature. So as I told you that my background has a lot of dark green too, so I'll be mixing black, dark green and yellow. Okay, after a lot of spill, so I have taken green, yellow, black and white. So this is like the initial amount, but I'll always go up and down with how much of green I need to mix. So this is the first layer of the background that I'm doing, and it doesn't have to be neat because there are several layers that are going to top, and so probably in the end this layer might not even be clearly visible, but nevertheless we'll try to make every layer its best to look at. So I've just taken one single glance at my reference photo and I'm just going through the greens, because I know it's not uniform and I can just play with the shades of green throughout the background. While you're just learning at home how to paint, here is one thing that you can also concentrate on. So whenever you're choosing a photograph to paint, so what you can do is you can learn to acquire the skill of looking at things in the form of layers, because no matter what photograph it is always present in layers. For example, the frame that you're looking at, the wall is the first layer, then me, I am the second layer, and all of this is the third layer. So if you were to paint all of this, you would go in the same exact order and not messing up. Now, as you see in the picture, the first layer was the green, the real green that doesn't even make sense. So after that comes the stems, the leaves, flowers are obviously the final layer. So now that we're getting into the second layer, let me show you how you do the second layer of stems. Oh yeah, I forgot to mention. So I am using a number 2 liner brush for doing the leaves. At this point, I don't even feel like I'm actually using a reference photo, because I've seen it once. I know that it has flowers, I know it has leaves, but I am choosing where the leaves are and how thin or how thick those leaves will be. So I would consider my second layer done. So now what we'll be doing is that we'll be going to the third layer, that is flowers. So as you see in the picture, there are around 10 to 12 flowers. So here what you need to understand about the flowers is that not all flowers are staring straight into the photograph, because some are bent, some are tilted at a different angle. It's only when you can interpret these details into your painting is when your painting would look realistic. So these circles tell you what direction your flower is in. For example, I'm doing an oval shape here. So this oval shape will show that the flower is facing that way. And if it's real circular, then that would say that it's staring straight into the camera of the person who's holding it while the photograph is being taken. So here the catch is, the number of circles show how many complete flowers are there in the picture, but whenever you're doing a photograph painting, I would definitely recommend you to paint half photos, as in here in the corners there are some places where there are just petals. Definitely do that and don't ditch them, because that really show a realistic look again. So the next thing here is that we are starting with the petals. So the petals are thin and long. The circles that we've just painted, that will be filling it in the end. So after the petals are done, I'll be going up, finally covering up the circles. Okay, so the first layer of the center part is done. So now that the green is done, I'll just surround it with yellow. So now that the circles are done, for the final part, what I'll be doing is I'll be doing the buds that I missed out in the beginning. So for the buds, no more drama, I'll just be adding some small circles here and there. One thing I forgot to mention in the start is about the palette. If you already have a new palette at home, that's fine. But what I use here is this acrylic sheet. So the best part of using this acrylic sheet when it comes to gouache is that no matter how many times you leave it, you can always, like I said, you can reactivate it by just pouring some water. Okay, I guess the painting is almost done. To be honest, there is no such point that can say that this would be the finish point of your painting, but once you're satisfied with what you've done, then that's the end. So now what I'm going to do is that I'll be peeling out these tape very carefully, because if I just do it at a stretch, it might tear the paper. So I might just be really careful, and I might pull this diagonally always. That will almost always will help you not tearing your paper. Okay, so now I'll be showing you how my final painting looks like. So this is a 4x6 lavender to lilac daisies. So like I mentioned in the beginning, I have done some similar paintings that I thought I would share with you, and all of these paintings are acrylic. So this is a scene of the evening that I just did of a backyard from a reference somewhere on the internet. Then I did one of these roses, which is in a similar design of this Polaroid, but that was like the first time I was trying it, so it doesn't really look so proportional, but that's okay. Then a very similar painting as of today's is these white daisies. But the only problem I faced while doing this is it took a lot of white paint in acrylic. And this again is a very simple field of flowers. But if you really want to see the difference, then this is how it looks. So the gouache gives a little more of a crayon type of look, but acrylics, they do not lose their shine, and it's been over a year that I've did this, but it just looks like how I did that day. So that's it for this video, guys. I just hope this video was of any help to you at all, and if it was, don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. So if you know anyone who's an art enthusiast, then don't forget to share this video with them. So if you have any recommendations or questions regarding this video or art in general or with the painting, you can always leave it in the comments below. I'll be very happy to clarify and help you all. And if you think I could have done anything better, you can also leave some suggestions for me so that I can follow that in my next videos. So until next time, don't forget to wear your mask and stay indoors.